就觉得安心，因为你那双爱笑眼睛，你笑
上恋人未满，甜蜜心烦，愉悦混乱。 是做朋友，再向前一点点
就会点头，
再冲动一点点我就不闪躲。
不过三个字你犹豫这么久，
直到你说出口你就能拥有我。
Okay, guys, let's continue with the lecture on network addressing. So before we go on to the next concept here, guys, okay, you can keep your chat later. In your short break, then you can continue chatting. But right now, let's get back to the lecture first. So before that, we stop at the slide where we talk about IP address, MAC address, and port numbers, okay? So some of you guys are still confused about how they are different or maybe what they are used for. And your friend here asked a question like, let's say, okay, so let's say if you chat to somebody, your friend on China using WeChat. So what is actually going on behind the scene? Now, to demonstrate this, I will show you this network here. And hopefully after this, you can get idea clearer. So over here, what do you have is two person, one in Malaysia. Maybe you can think of this, that the orange color one is in Malaysia and the other one, your friend, is in China, the green color one. So you are using the WeChat on your phone and you're chatting to a friend in China and he is replying to you on WeChat desktop or WeChat apps, WeChat web. Okay, which is why you have a laptop there. So again, like we have said about earlier, every device need IP, need a MAC, and need a port number to go online or to use the network. So on the left-hand side, you have the phone that is using 192.168.1.1, which is the IP address given by the router in the orange color network. And the MAC address is AA BBCC 112233 for the mobile phone. Now on the right-hand side, you have the laptop that is using 10.10.10.10 with the MAC address ABCDEF112218. So that is the hardware address for both of these devices. And right now, what is happening is they are chatting on WeChat. Okay, so right now I'm going to explain to you what happened when the guy using the phone. Okay, so maybe we just call this Alex, so that it is clearer for you. So on Alex is chatting to Arvo. So Alex is in Malaysia, Arvo is in China. So when Alex send a WeChat message to Arvo, okay, we think of this in this example, okay, because it can go both ways. Arvo can reply, but right now the example that I'll give you is from Alex to Arvo. Now over here, you see there is a WeChat server in the middle, which is true for client-server architectures. Okay, I will explain the WeChat server first, but later on in the example, I will remove the server, otherwise you might be confused. But I still want to show you that there is a server sitting in between because that is how the internet works. When you talk on WeChat, it doesn't mean that you are talking to your friend directly. Everything that you are sending to your friend will go to the WeChat server first, and the WeChat server will send that message to your friend in China. Okay, so you always have this client-server architecture, even for YouTube. So for this stream right now, I'm sending my video onto YouTube server, and you are streaming from YouTube server, okay? So that is how the internet works, but I will remove this one for sake of clarity so that you're not confused. And just imagine that you have these two guys that talks on WeChat, but remember, this is not peer-to-peer. It is always client-server, okay? So when Alex sent a packet to Arvo, you will get something like this. So this is exactly the packet that will go from Alex's mobile phone going to Arvo's laptop. Okay, now Okay, now in this case, you see, over here, everything that you see, we call this the destination information, meaning that where do you want to get to? Okay, and remember, we need three informations, and the IP address, the destination IP is AWO, because Alex sent to AWO. So this one here is AWO IP. Okay, this packet is going to avocado laptop, so this one is AWO MAC address, the network card address in AWO's laptop, and this one here is the port number for WeChat. Okay, now this number, it will be different depending on what device that you are running. So your port number and your friend port number, sometimes it will be the same, sometimes it might be different. That's okay. Now in the example that I give here, it is different. Okay, so if you zoom this out and then you see this, the reason you have this packet here, let me bring this up so that you get some context, is that because Alex is sending to AWO, so you have this destination IP, this MAC address here, and this port number refers to the WeChat apps in AWO's PC. So what does it mean to us is that you see, with all these three informations, the packet can get from Alex's phone to AWO PC end-to-end because, first thing, I will use the IP address. Now, you have to understand that there are so many networks and devices on the internet, right? So, let's say you have other PC here. So, all the squares here represents PC. So, how can we make sure that these packets, I will put it in purple color, how can we make sure that this packet goes from Alex to AWO instead of going to some other host somewhere on the internet? This is done by using the IP address. So because we see this packet here needs to go to 10.10.10.10, and we know that 10.10.10.10 is in the green color network. So that is what IP address is for. It will go from the right network, source network, to the destination network instead of going to the wrong network. Okay, now once the packet arrive in green color network in China, the next thing that you need is this MAC address. Okay, so I will expand this network so that you get the idea of MAC address. For example here, in China, okay, maybe AWO is sharing the internet with his girlfriend, say Taylor Swift. So Taylor Swift has another laptop here. So when the packet arrives in China, from here all the way here, there are two places this packet can go. It can either go to Taylor, or it can either go to the AWO, which is the right destination. So how does the switch, in this case it is the switch, decide whether who get the packet? Should it be AWO who get the packet, or should it be Taylor who get the packet? Okay, now this is done by using the second line here, the MAC address. Because, like we said earlier, every device has a unique MAC address. So by checking this number, I know that this packet here, it should go to AWO because it is having this MAC address. So that is what MAC address is for. In a network, you have many devices. By checking the destination MAC, I can know this packet should go to which device on the LAN. Now, the last thing is the port number. So like we said earlier, on a laptop, you're running many programs at the same time. So if this packet already finally arrived here, which is a good news, it arrived at the right destination, but we don't want the WeChat message to appear on Facebook, you know. Have you ever seen a case where I message you, let's go for a movie on WeChat, and then that message appear on your Facebook Messenger? No, that can never happen because we have port number. And port number, you have a port number for every applications. And how do your operating system know this packet should go to WeChat or goes to WhatsApp or goes to Instagram? They will check this port number. Now this one, 666. Yeah, 666. And then this one have to send to WeChat. So that is what port number is for. So you see, the whole thing that happens, you have three addresses that work together. You need all three of them. And with IP, you can get to the right network. With MAC address, you get to the right host. With port number, you get to the right applications. So that explain port, that explain IP, MAC and port, okay? So, have I answered your questions? Just now I remember some people is asking about this. So if you're clear, then we go on to the next one. Let me know in the comments below if you think you're ready for the next one. We are very lucky because we have Angie who is entertaining our guests from the other country. So thank you, Angie, for keeping our guests happy. Now, IP is country, port is city, MAC is home address. Yes, you can think of this. One way to put it is this. That's correct. There's just a hierarchy here. You see, the example that I've given here is one way to see it. And if you want to follow the example that I gave earlier, so let's say you buy a parcel from Lazada and the parcel is shipped from Kuala Lumpur, KL to Penang. So from KL to Penang, we check the area code. So the area code is kind of like your network address, which is the IP address. And then when this parcel arrives in Penang, it will be delivered to your house. So how do I know which house to be delivered to? I check your MAC address. And when the parcel finally arrives at your house, there are many people living in that house. So should the parcel be given to you or your dad or your mom or your cat or your dog, that will look at the port number, which is your IC number that is printed. That's why the postman always say, what is your IC number when you get a parcel? Okay, so something like that. Okay, another good question here. If MAC address can identify device, why cannot has the same IP? Okay, you have to think about it in this way. If I want to really explain, I have to draw another diagram. But the simple answer is that, like I said, because you see, the first thing when the device want to send something to another device, they will do a check. So they will check whether the destination is in the same network or it is on another network. Now, if you have the two IP, same IP, then during the check, you will have some issues. Maybe you'll get this clearer in a while when I show you what happened when you are sending packets, okay? But for now, just think of it that you cannot have two IP, although, yeah, what you say is right. Since we already have MAC address, we don't really need IP to uniquely identify hosts. That is one reason. Second reason is, because you need, over here, all the examples that I give you, I am the one who tell you what is the MAC address. I am the one who tell you what is the IP. But in the real computer network, the device do not know what is the MAC address. So for example, using MAC, the same example here, when Alex want to send a packet to Owl, Alex do not know what is the MAC address of Owl computer. Okay, he need to do a process we call the ARP process, which stands for ARP, Address Resolution Protocol. And when you do the ARP request, I will find out what is the MAC address of the destination host that I'm trying to send to. And to use ARP, you need to have a unique IP address for each of the hosts in a local area network. So that is called ARP. And you will also be learning about ARP in some other lectures, in the few last lectures, so don't worry about that for now. Okay, so I will keep on answering your questions while your other friend is entertaining our new friend from the other country. Please make sure that you're talking to Americans now. Okay, possible to have two adapter with same MAC. Okay, Chiwa is asking a good question here. So can you have two MAC address, two adapter with same MAC address if they are built by the manufacturer? In fact, no. So I give you another example here since you already asked about this. So over here, this is an example of a MAC address. So if you are not familiar, a MAC address is... just give me a minute, I'm charging up Apple Pencil because I think even my pencil is tired. So now, look at this here. While we are waiting, you can try to look at the MAC address here. And you should see that there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 6 bytes, okay? So you will see there are 6 bytes of value in each of the MAC address. So you have like AA, BB, CC, DD, EFF, okay? 6 bytes. So to write this down, let's say you have AA, BB, CC, 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3. That is a standard MAC address. That's how a MAC address looks like. And it is 6 bytes in length. So for those who are not familiar with this, these are hex number, okay? So every hex number is 4 bits. If you have 2 hex number, then you get 1 byte, which means that this one is 1 byte, 1 byte, 1 byte, okay? All of this is 1 byte. So in total, for a MAC address, is 6 bytes. Okay, now next thing here, you should know that the first 3 bytes is where you can know who manufactured the network card. So these 3 bytes, the front 3 bytes, is actually the manufacturer ID. Meaning that Cisco, they have their own number. Apple have their own number. Huawei have their own number. By looking at here, the first 3 bytes, you can know who is the one who built your card. This is the manufacturer identifier. Okay? Now the last 3 bytes is the unique identifier for each of the individual card. Meaning that Huawei, for example, AABBCC is Huawei. Then Huawei can build 1 million cards. So all of the cards will have different number in the last 3 bytes. But the front part, if Huawei, then it is always the same for Huawei. If you see something like, oh, this number, then maybe it is from Intel. Okay, so the point is, this is the MAC address. First 3 bytes is used to identify who built the card. The last 3 bytes is used to identify the card number, the IC number for the card. Now, in fact, if you want to know who built your card, you can go to find out what is your MAC address. Do you still remember how to find your MAC address? Go to ipconfig, go to command prompt. If you type ipconfig/all, you will see your MAC address. You can paste that address onto Google. There's a website called, let me find this for you, so that I can just show this to you. Where's my mouse? So in fact, let's try this. Yeah, of course it has to be unique. It is called MAC address lookup. Vendor lookup. And with this, there are many websites that you can do this, and you can actually see who built your card. So for example, let's try the first link here, and let's find out who built this card. Okay, I'm not sure whether it works, but let's try this. So over here I have 00C0CA, so I will just type in 00C0CA84BB. Yeah, so this is my MAC address here, C0. And let's try to see whether they can find this. Where is the search button? Don't see any search button here. Okay, never mind. Let's try another link. Some of the link work, some doesn't work. So let's find a one that works. And then let's see who built this card. So yeah, you see, when I put this in, for those who can see on the screen, it is actually alpha. So it is true, you see, alpha is the one. So I'm not lying, say alpha is printed here. And then if you look at the screen, alpha is the company who built this card. So you can try this on your own to see if somebody sell you a gaming network card. So no more lag, okay? No unify, also no lag. And maybe it is not true. You can find out from here. Okay, now for those who want to know what is your MAC address, I'm sorry, I don't have a Windows machine here. I cannot show that to you. But I will use a screenshot to show you. Let me get a bigger, one with better resolutions for you. So for those who are running Windows, if you want to find out what is your MAC address, so this is it. If you are running on Wi-Fi, make sure that you look at this thing called the wireless LAN adapter. If you are running on, okay, so if you are using Wi-Fi, make sure you are looking at this one. If you are using the Ethernet, then you are using this one. And here, the physical address. If you can see the physical address, then you will see this is your MAC address that you are currently using to get online right now. Okay, so guys, if you are fine with all these things, then we'll move on to the next one because hardcore things are coming up. So, are you ready for the next concept video? So I see you guys are making friends with Monita and Grace. So is Monita and Grace one person or two person? Okay, ready for the next one? So here you are looking at the mini map of our... Wait, let me see where we are. Okay, so this one. This is an example of an IPv4 address. An IPv4 address is 32 bits long. There are 4 octets in each IPv4 address. Starting from the left, you have octet number 1, octet number 2, octet number 3, and octet number 4 going to the right. Each octet in the IPv4 address is 8 bits long, which gives us the total of 32 bits long IPv4 address. For your information, 8 bits is equal to 1 byte. In other words, an IPv4 address is 4 bytes long. If you think about it, the total number of IPv4 address that we can have on the internet is given by 2 to the power of 32, which translates to 4294967295 number of IP addresses. Wow, that's a lot of IP address. IPv4 address is normally accompanied by what we call the subnet mask. Subnet mask can be any number from 1 to 32. In this example, you have a /8 subnet mask. Subnet mask is important to determine the boundary of a network. You should know that subnet mask can be written as a slash notation, which is what you're seeing here, or it can also be written as a decimal notation or a binary notation. We'll talk more about subnet mask in a short while. In this example, you are seeing an IPv4 address written in the decimal notation. In some cases, IPv4 address can also be represented in the binary notation. We can easily translate a decimal IP address into the binary format using the IP calculator or any scientific calculator that supports decimal to binary conversions. In our case, pressing the calculator, we can translate 192 into 11000000, and similarly, we can also translate 168 into 10101000. Doing the same for decimal 1, we get 00000001 as the binary notation. So there you have it. What you're seeing now in green color is exactly the same IP address that is represented in the binary notation instead of the decimal notation. So guys, what you have seen earlier is the structure of IP port address. And now it is very important for you to understand this address structure properly, because later on we'll be using IP port address to calculate the network address range. And with the calculations, with the results, then we can go on to help Bob to build his network. Okay, so if you remember, we have Bob the Builder waiting for us. And what we need to do today really is to find out how to calculate IP address, and using what we calculated, we'll assign IP address onto the PC in Bob Networks so that Bob can get Employee of the Month award. Now, but before we can help him, of course, we have to learn how to calculate addressing first. And the first two things that you should know is you need to learn about IP address and subnet mask. Now, again, in this subject, we are not going to into details about how do you do binary to decimal conversions or the other way around, because you have already learned this in some other subjects. But we'll be doing all this using the calculator, which I think is okay, because in this semester everything will be online, right? So in your final assessment, again, you can use any calculator of your choice. If you are those kind of student who like to hold a real physical calculator, the one that you always bring into the lectures hall, go ahead to use those. For those who are using PCs, in fact, on Windows 10, there is a calculator built-in, which is very useful if you want to do binary to decimal conversions or hex to decimal conversions. But you need to turn on the programmer mode, okay? Now, again, for my case, later on, I'll be showing you an online calculator that I found on the web, which I think is very simple, and I'll be using that calculator throughout this stream. So next thing is you want to learn about subnet mask. Now this part is hardcore, so you have to pay attention, and to help you with the visual, you need to open up your slides and go to slide number 14. Okay, so over here I have your slides up, and for those who haven't got this, it is already up on Babel. We will not go through all the slides because most of the thing has been explained earlier. But this slide, this is important. Okay, so go to the slides and then go to slide number 14, where you will see the IP address structures. Okay, now first you have already know what is IP address. That is the address that you need to when you join any network. In IP address, there are 32 bits. But the next thing you want to know is how do we find out how big or how small is the network? So you should know that there are networks that is very small, because maybe in a small company, I have only 10 employees, so I only have a small network. On another end, you have Google and Apple, those big companies where you have 10 of millions of employees. Then to connect all of them, you need to have a very big network. Okay, so you have small network and you have big networks. So I want you to think of this as a piece of cake. Now, for example, what you're seeing here, this one, let's say you bought a cake. Okay, so this is a cake, and now you want to cut the cake and share this cake to some other people, right? So there are many ways you can cut the cake depending on what is your strategy. And let's say I have a cake here, and then I want to cut it half for my girlfriend, because I love my girlfriend as much as I love myself. So I just cut it half, and then the left side is for my girlfriend, the right side is for me. Or maybe you have a cake, and then now I said, okay, I'm on diet, I do not want to take too much sugar, so I'll just take one slice. So you can just cut a small slice here, and then you can take only one slice. So you can even take here, because you see, this one here in red color is still one slice. So that is how you can cut a cake. So I want you to use the same concept and think about this circle here is all the IP address that you have on the internet. Every IP address starting from the first one all the way until the last one. And in fact, all the IP address that is available for us start from R0.0.0.0 all the way up to 255.255.255.255. So this is all the IP address in this world. And let's think of this cake as the whole IP address that's available to us. So you see the range here. And the next question is, how can I cut this cake so that everyone in this world get to have an IP address? So for example, today I think most of you are connected using UniFi and you subscribe to UniFi through TM. So TM is our internet service provider, our ISP. And some people might be using Maxis Fiber, so your ISP is Maxis. If you're using mobile data, then maybe you're on U-Mobile, Cellcom, or some other telco. So ISP and telco, they are the same thing. But remember, everyone needs IP to go to the internet. When you subscribe to any internet service, your ISP will give you one IP address, at least one, to your router, so that everyone in your network can go to the internet. But who is the one who give your ISP the IP address? Okay, now that is the body we call IANA or IANA. So you can think of IANA as, it's not a secret agent, it's just a government body that control all the IP address in this world, all the IP vault address. It means that all the ISP like TM, Maxis, Cellcom, they need to go to this IANA, they need to buy IP address from this IANA, and maybe you want to buy how many, 100,000, 200,000, then IANA will cut the cake and allocate the address for the ISP. So for example, now I have a cake here. So let's say TM, you know most of us are using TM, have so many customers. So TM need a lot of IP address. So what TM do is they will pay IANA some money, and IANA will say, okay, you are a big telco, I will give you this big slice of cake. Then all the IP address inside here, So let's say, okay, look at the circle here. Now, the way IANA cut this is because TM pay them more money, so I'll cut a big slice in orange color, and this one I'll give to TM. Okay, now Maxis is also quite popular, but not as big as TM, so maybe I don't need that much. I pay you less money, so I get a smaller slice of cake. So this one here is for Maxis. So you see, what we are having here is all the IP address that's available, and IANA is the one who say who can use what IP address starting from what range. So that is how we slice the IP address in the computer network. Now, the second thing is that when we want to slice, let's say I get an IP from TM. When I'm in my home network, I can have many other devices, right? So in my home network, I will share one IP address to all the devices in a local area network. Meaning that if I have one iPhone, one MacBook, and one iPad in my home network, all these three devices, they will share the same public IP when they go to the internet. That is why every time you subscribe to one UniFi account, you only get one IP address. But that doesn't mean that only one device in your LAN can go online. All of us can go online together. But when we go online, all of us in the same LAN will share one public address. This is important because we cannot have all devices to use one unique IP when you go to the internet. Okay, we don't have that many IP. So the point here is, when you go to the internet, you are using the public IP address that is given by your ISP. But within your own local area network, you will use what we call the private IP address, which is what we have been seeing all the while. We have 192.168.1.1. All these IP address is private IP. Okay, so that is one important thing. Now the second thing is that when it comes to slicing, this cake that you are seeing here, we cannot just simply slice as we like it. We have to slice in a way that it is effective. For example, if I have a few IP address and then I want to assign to two different companies. So let's say if I have 10 IP address, okay, 10. And then I have two companies who need to share this 10 IP address. So company A is a big company. Company B is small company. Okay, so I will just write this down so that it is clearer for you. So let's say you have two companies here. So say you have 10 IP address. So you have company A and company B. So company A right now, I have 5 staff. Company B, I have only 2 staff. Okay, so you see, when I have these 10 IP, I need to find a way to assign to these two companies that will be in 2 different local area network so that all of the staff can get an IP address. Okay, so for that, we need to slice the cake properly. Now, going back to the slide here, how do we slice the cake? Is by using the subnet mask. Okay, so we will learn about subnet mask now, which is the next important concept here. So I want you to take a look at this IP address on the screen. You have 192.168.100.100. Okay, now for an IPv4 address, actually they can be divided into 2 parts. Okay, we call this the network bits and the host bits. So on the slides that you see here, 192.168 currently is the network bits, 100.100 is the host bits. Now, why do we need to split one address to network and then to host? The reason is because the first part, the left-hand side where we call the network bits, are all the numbers that we can use to build or create more network. Okay, the number on the right, the host bit, are all the numbers that we use to assign IP to end devices. Now this is important, so you have to get this right. On the internet, there are so many networks. For example, you have Apple, you have Google, you have Utah. Okay, this is the internet. Now every company need to have their own network address. So let's say Apple get 192.168.1.0. Okay, then Google get 10.10.10.0. Then Utah get 172.10.10.0. For an example, okay? Now, you see, if every company need to have a network address, it means that we need to have many numbers so that we can arrange or assign to all the companies. So the numbers that we can use to build different network for different company come from here. We call this the network bits. Okay, now for example here, if you have seen the slide earlier about IPv4, you know that each octet in IPv4 is 8 bits, correct? So in this example here, I have 192.168 as the network bits, meaning that I'm cutting the address in half. So when I cut the address in half, this line that is cutting the address, it is the subnet mask. Okay, so remember, first octet is 8 bits. So this is the first octet here. This is 8 bits. This is the second octet here. Again, this is another 8 bits. So in total, you have 16 bits here. Okay, now on the right hand side, again, this is the third octet, so 8 bits here. And then another 8 bits here. So again here, I have 16 bits. Okay, now, That means that I have 16 bit of network bit that I can use to build network. So if I ask you a question, if I have this kind of addressing, okay, how many number of network can I build? You can easily find this out by taking 2 to the power of 16, because you have 16 bits of network. So over here, because I have 16 bit here, if I take 2 to the power of 16, I'll get a very big number, and that is the maximum number of network I can build if I have this kind of addressing. Okay, so that's the first part about network bits. Now, another example here, if I take this same address, okay, let me give you another example here. So if you want to look at the slide, you can go to slide number 16. And now you see the line, the subnet mask line, move to the right a little bit. So over here, you have 8 bit here. The second octet is 8 bit. The third octet is again 8 bit. The last octet is 8 bit. So in this example, we have a slash 24 mask, which means that I have 24 bits for the network bits, which is why I have the line cut here. So for you to find out, you can easily calculate 8 plus 8 is 16 plus another 8 is 24. So if I draw a line here, this is actually a slash 24 mask. So right now what I'm showing you is how do we cut the cake, okay? How do we cut the IPv4 address using the subnet mask? So again, in this example, the reason I cut at the third octet is because I have a slash 24 mask. This is the mask. And with three octets, I know that I have 24 bits, so I will cut at the after the third octet. Now, going back to the first example in slide number 14, if I cut at the middle, right in the middle, the mask is actually a slash 16 mask. Because if you look here, I have 8 plus 8 is equal to 16. So if you see a line in the middle, it means that this address is having a slash 16 mask. Okay, so just to make this clear, let me give you one more example here. Now, if you see an IP address 10.10.10.10 slash, let's say slash 8. So over here, you know that we have a slash 8 mask. And if you want to know how, where do you cut this, you have to draw the line here. So the first octet is slash 8, the second octet is slash 16, the third octet is slash 24. Now if I have a slash 8 mask, I will cut at the very first octet, right after the very first octet, which is where I have all the 8 bits for network. So you have to remember, what does this mean? It means that this addressing scheme, the first 8 bits is reserved for the network bits, this one here. So over here, this is the net bit. And the last, the remaining bits will be for the host bit, which is what you're seeing here. So this is the very first important concept that you should know. For an IPv4 address, we have network bits and we have host bits. How do we draw the line between network and host is determined by the subnet mask. And you have already seen the example of a slash 8 mask, a slash 16 mask, and a slash 24 mask. So by now you should know where to cut the address. Now going back to the concept of host bit and network bit. Now in the earlier example, we say that with all the network bits, okay, you can build many, many networks. Now, for example, if I want to build more networks, what can I do here? So in this example, I know that I can build 2 to the power of 16 number of networks. What if I need to build more? Let's say I have used up all the address here. The easy thing to do is you need to expand the network bits so that you have more. When you have more network bits, you can build more networks. So for example, I can move the line here. If I move the line here, That means, okay, right now this is a /16, right? If I move the line one octet away, then it becomes a /24. This one becomes a /24. So initially, I only have 2 to the power of 16 bits that I can use to build network. Now I have a total of 24 bits, which means that the new number of network that I can build is 2 to the power of 24, which is even a greater number than 2 to the power of 16. And with that, you can build even more networks. Okay, now, on the other side, what if I don't want to build that many networks? I want to build less number of networks. So in that case, I can move the subnet mask to the left. For example, now this is a /16. I can easily move this here, and this will become a /8. Because you only have one octet. I'm cutting at the first octet here. And with that, the maximum number of networks I can build is 2 to the power of 8. Which is not that many networks. But there is a reason for that. Okay, so if you are thinking, then why do I want to do something like that? Okay, you have to know that if you haven't noticed this already, IPv4 maximum is only 32 bits. And it depends on how we slide the subnet mask. Okay, if I slide the subnet mask to the right to build more networks, so let's say starting from a /16, I move this line here to a /24. What it also means is that it is cutting into our host speed, meaning that we have only less number of host speed remaining, which also means I do not have that many IP address left to be assigned to the host. Now, if you're not clear, let me give you an example first. The front part, network bit, you use to create network address, network ID. So in every network, say this is a LAN 1, okay? In every network, you have many PC, you have PC1, PC2, okay? Something like this. Now, every node in the network needs an IP address. So this number here in the host bit is all the IP that you can use to give to the host. So again, front part is all the IP you can use to create network for a different company or different home network. The host bit part is for the network that you have created. These are the IP address that you can use to assign to the host in the network that you have just created. Okay, which brings us back to the example here. If we go to /24, it means that I have more network bits. Now I can build more network. Okay, I have 24 bits. But I also take away some of the network, some of the host bit. Means that in the network that I've created, the number of IP that is left for me to assign to the host is actually much lesser because they are already used to build network. Okay, now the same thing here, if you want to build a network that is very big, for example, a network that have 100,000 employees, then if you are doing something like this, okay, so this is a great example because you see, you only have this much of the bit left, so 2 to the power of 8 left for the host, which might not be enough. So to fix this, you can easily move the subnet mask to the left. So you only have 8 bits for the network, but the remaining 2 to the power of 24 will be for the host, which means that the network that you can build is not that many network anymore, but in each of the network, you can have so many IP address left that you can assign to the host in that network. Okay, so that explains how network bit and host bit is different and how they are used to cut the line to know how big or how small a network is. Okay, so before I go further, I will check out your question first about subnet mask, and then I will show you how do you calculate this subnet mask. Now for those who want to get the concept about what I've just explained, there's a slide for that. It is on slide number 17. This slide shows you that we can always move the bit left and right depending on whether you want to have more network with less number of hosts, or you want to have less network, but in each of the network you can have more number of hosts inside the network. Okay, now I guess you guys are really, you guys understand this, which is why you're asking a great question here. How do we know the number of bits? And is the number of bits fixed? Okay, now I'll answer all of these questions by giving you an example. And the simple answer is the number of bits is not fixed. Okay, it can change from any subnet mask. So for example, I can have a /8, /16, /24 mask, or I can even have a /9, /10. Okay, your subnet mask can be any number starting from /1 until /32. But normally we don't use a /1, because if you do a /1, you only have one bit left for the network bits. That means you only can build two networks. Do you think on the internet there's only two networks? That's not possible. Now, on the other end, we also don't use a /32, because if you use a /32, it means that you use up all the bits to build network, and in the network, there is no bit for you to assign IP to the host, so that doesn't work as well. So normally, for us, on the internet, the right practice is we'll use /8 to /30. Theoretically, you can start /1 to /32, but you know you will not be able to build any good networks, which is why the better addressing is starting from /8 to /30. So Angela has a question. Move it just to get more bits for host. Yes. And that is actually a very good advantage. For example, if in Utah I don't have enough bits for the host bits, then some of the PC in the lab will not get an IP address. Okay? Which is why it is important to know how big is your company, how many PC that needs to connect to the network, and then you will decide how many host bits do you need to have. Okay, so Angie has another question. What is host bits for? Host bit is used to assign IP to the PC in your network. Okay, the network bit is used to create network. In every network, you have many PC. Okay, all these PC need to have IP. So the host bits are the IP that left for you to assign, to be assigned to the host in the local area network. Okay, now if I missed any of your questions here, then I just scroll through. If I missed, just retype the question so I get it. So that's another question. Then how is /28 and /15? Okay, now over here, there is a slide that shows you /28. Don't worry about that one first, because in a short while, I will show you what does the /28 means. Okay. For now, it is too early, so we'll skip this one first. We'll come back to this. So again, for those who didn't get them earlier, the best subnet mask that you can use, you should start from /8 all the way up to /30. Okay, now next question. Can you change the subnet mask by yourself? Yes, you can easily change the subnet mask when you configure static IP in your machine. In fact, later on when we help Bob to build his network, we will also change the subnet mask for him. Okay. The more bits for network means host can have stronger network. No. You are from another planet. When you have more bits for network, it means that you can build more network for more company. It doesn't mean that you have stronger network. Unless you mean stronger network means you have more hosts, that is stronger network. Okay, so I guess that is fine for all the questions here. So now, next, we'll get into, okay, we have one more questions. Don't worry, because these are, you are still new. This is first time, so it's fine, Tan. But anyway, I don't quite get what you mean by strong network, but just to make it easy for you, just think of it that if you want to have more networks, you put more network bits. If you want to have more people in a network, you keep more bits for the host bits. It's that simple. Okay? So host bit is left for us to assign. Yes, Angie, you got it right. That is a very beautiful way to explain that. So for those who don't get what I'm saying here, if you look at the chat, Angie has explained that very clearly in one sentence, okay? So when we use network, more host bit will let us lag. Okay, that is a very cute question here, Li Kai. When you are using network, okay, if you have a network that can put many, many hosts, which means that you have many host bits, in most cases, it will not make you to be lag. Because unless all the IP address is being used up, then there is a chance that it will be lagging. Okay, this is a very good question, but theoretically, it doesn't mean that if you have more host bit, you'll be more lag. But in practical, yes, it can happen. And the reason is because we have this thing called a broadcast message, which is a message that is sent to everyone on the network. Just like if you read your email, Mailmaster is sent to all the students. So in network, we have this broadcast message that will be sent to all the hosts. So for example, if you have a network with a lot of host bits and all the IP addresses are being taken up, then when you send a message to everybody, you are sending it to a lot of people, a lot of hosts, and that will make your network to be lag. For example, if you can have a lot of host bits, okay, but only two people in the network, only two IP addresses is used. So in that case, it wouldn't make too much of a difference in terms of whether you will be more lag or it wouldn't be lag, okay? Okay, so I think you are fine with this. Now, the next thing you want to learn is how do we represent a subnet mask? So for that, I need you to go back to your slide, and there is a slide on, go to slide number 18. Okay, so guys, you should be seeing a classful addressing. Okay, before that, there's one more question here. Let me just finish up the questions and then I'll get to the classful address. Jia Le is asking what is different between IP address and IPv4 address. They are both the same thing. So when I say IP address, I'm referring to IPv4. So if one day you learn more advanced networking, sometimes people will refer IP as IPv6. But in this subject, all IP is IPv4. Okay. Now guys, what you're seeing here on the screen, we call this classful addressing. So the next thing you should know is, on the internet, IPv4, there are two types of IPv4. We have classful and classless addressing. Classful means you've got class, okay? Classless means you don't follow class. So class, what kind of class do we have? We have class A, class B, class C, class D, and class E. In fact, we have 5 classes. So what you see on the slide is only 3 class because I don't want to confuse you, but if you really want to know, there are 5 class in total, A, B, C, D, E. Okay? Now, just now, when we talk about subnet mask, you have seen that we have /8, /16, and /24. So when we have a /8 mask, what does it mean is that we have 8 bits of 1 in the place of network bit. Okay, so if you look at class A address, class A have a /8 mask. This is fixed. Class B have /16. Class C have /24. Now, before we go further, you can already tell. That means if I want to build a network that can put many, many hosts, I should use class A because I have more host bits. If I want to build more networks and every network is only need small number of IP, I should use a class C because I have more network bits in class C. If you think about that, then yes, you are right. And technically, it means that a /8 means you have 8-1 in the network bits. So over here, the first octet here, every octet you have 8 bits, so first one, 8 bits. The remaining 24 bits are all 0. If you go to class D, you have 16 bits that is used for network, another 16 remaining is used for host. So half-half, okay? That's why you get a /16. Now, for class C, the first 3 octets is used as network, only the last remaining octet is left for for the host, which is why you have a /24, because 3 octet combined 8 plus 8 plus 8 combined, you will get 24. Okay, now this explains that in the classful addressing, you have to choose between, you want a big network, then you use class A. You want more network, but small network, you use class C. Okay, and this is actually a bit of problem for us, because you see, if you say so, okay, if you say that you can choose between this, then everybody will choose class A, because maybe even if I only have 2 PC, okay, forever alone, but I can choose class A, who cares, right? If you do so, that means you are wasting IP addresses. Now, if I choose class C, I'm saving IP, correct? Because I only keep 1 octet to be used as IP address. But if I do not have enough, then it is also a problem, because I need to create a new network if I don't have enough IP in my existing network. So classful is actually kind of, we say they are not really flexible in terms of sometimes you are wasting IP or sometimes you do not have enough IP, which is why we have moved on to classless addressing. And when we say classless, what it really means is that you might come across this term called CIDR. So over here, CIDR stands for classless inter-domain routing, which is exactly the same thing except they are not fixed to 8, 16, 24. Instead, they can be any number from 8 to 30, which means it can be /9, /10. Okay, now when you have that, it is called a classless inter-domain routing or classless addressing, okay, CIDR. So in today's computer network, I think most of the network has already moved to the CIDR addressing. Okay, now that is class ABC. We are still in class full right now. And the next slide that you see here, this is a very important slide for you to do calculations later. And what you have here is the different notations that we can write in subnet mask. Okay, now I'll finish this one first. Once you are clear about this, we'll take a short break. And when we come back, we can help. We can start to help. Okay, we have just a little bit more to go. And yeah, over here, what do we have is a slash notation, a decimal, and binary. So what you need to know is, when we write a subnet mask, earlier we see /8/16. That is called a slash notation. Okay, another way to write a subnet mask is write them as the binary notation. So if I write in binary, I have 1111 here and then 00. I will show you in a while how I get this value. The third notation here is decimal notation. So all these are the same value written in different representation. Now, why we have three different notation? Why want to make it so hard? Reason is because slash notation is very easy to write. Now, in the exam, when we want to write subnet mask, we always write slash notation, right? Because it's very easy, slash number, that's it. But the machine cannot understand slash notation. He can only understand decimal notation, which means that if you configure a router or a PC, when you want to put in the subnet mask, you cannot write slash. You have to type 255.0.0.0. Machine only understands decimal notation. Okay, now, and then we have this binary notation, which is important only if you want to do some network calculations to find the network addresses. Then you need to convert it from decimal to binary notation. So again, we have three notations here. And we'll see how I get all this value. So here, I think, guys, you're right. Most of you, if you check your network right now, you are actually using a class C address. But like I said earlier, although you are on /24, you are not actually on class C. We are all already in the classless addressing, where what I mean is there is no more class, okay? There is just /something. So anyway, coming back to this one here, right now we want to see a /8/16 and /24. Now, in a slash notation, a /8 means you have 8 bits of 1 in place of network bits. So if I draw something like this here, and every octet is slash. Remember, every octet you have 8 bits, okay? So we start with the first example first. Now, perhaps you don't have to draw this. So for a slash 8 mask, what you see here on the left is all the masks, and I will translate them into binary notation first. So slash 8 means in the first octet I have 8111111111. Okay, all the rest is 80 here. And then all here is 080 here. For the last octet again, we have 8 more zeros here. Okay, now slash 16 means that I have 16 bit of network bit. Okay, before that I will just color this for you. The red color one is the network, the green color one is the host. Okay, so for 16, I have 16 bit for network, I have remaining 16 for host. So I have 1111111111111111 here. And the rest all zero. Okay, now for a slash 24, I have 24 bits here, all 1, and then the rest host bit is all 0. So over here I have 1111111 again. For second octet I have 8 ones. For the third octet I have another 8 ones, and the last octet is all 0. That is the binary representation of the subnet mask. Okay, now if I want to write this in decimal, you can just press your calculator. And I will show you my favorite calculator. I will use this. This is a website that I found online that allowed me to do the binary to decimal conversions. And okay, again, you can use scientific calculator. You can use the calculator on Windows. If you want to follow me, I'm using this calculator from the website called Rapid Tables. This is not an ad. I'm not using because they are sponsoring me. Just that I found this to be simple, so I will be using this. So over here, you have a calculator, and what you want to do is you want to go from binary to decimal. You have to make sure that you are in the right conversions, binary to decimal. And the first thing we want to translate now is all ones. So over here, I put 8 ones. You press convert, you'll get the decimal for 8 ones, which is translate to 255. Now, if you press for all zeros, you'll translate to 0, 0, 0. So that means a slash 8, if I write in decimal notation, is 255.0.0.0. Now, we'll do the same for 16. So we don't have to press calculator anymore. We know that if you press, it will give you 255. So here you have 255.255.0.0. And doing the same for the last one, you have 3255.255.255.255.0. So that is the decimal representation of the same subnet mask of slash 8, 16, and 24. So you have to get this right first before we go on to the next example. Okay, now if we are okay with this, then one advanced example is, remember we say now we are in CIDR, which means it can be any number other than these three. So let's say if I have a slash 25 mask. So slash 25 means I have 25 bits that is used for the network bits, which means that if I want to represent this in binary, it will be 1111111, so 8 ones here. Okay, let me hide my face for a while. So 8 ones here. Then you have 1111111, so 16 already. Another 8 will bring this up to 241. Okay, so that is slash 24. And then because this is a 25, you need to take one more bit here. One more. In the last octet, the first bit of the last one, that will also be your network bit because this is a slash 25, and then the remaining 7 will be 0. That is a slash 25 mask. Okay, now if I have slash 28, it means that I have 1111. Again, I'll have 8 ones here, another 8 1, another 8 1. Now here, start from here, this is a slash 94. So if I add 1, 25, 26, 27, 28, and the rest is all 0. So which means that all here will be network. The last 4 bits will be for the host. That's a slash 98 mask. So until now, are you clear about how do we represent subnet mask in different way? If you're okay, let me know if you're okay, and then we take a 5-minute break. When we come back, we will use what we have just learned to calculate for network addressing. Okay? Let me know if you're okay in the comment below before we start our 5-minute break. Okay, cool. So I'll see you back in 5 minutes, 11:55. I'll see you again. So take a short break. We're going to have a coffee, a lunch, or whatever. But please make sure that you come back.
Thank you.
guys. Hey, welcome back. And yeah, it's me again. Nice to meet you again. So we have really one more session to go, which is to help Bob to finish up the network that he has built. So to do so, you have to open up the package tracer file, Bob the Builder. If you haven't already downloaded, it is already up on Babel. So go and get it. And then give me 1 minute to open up the file, and we'll do this together, and hopefully we have enough time to finish the challenge. And if by chance we don't have enough time, I will show you how to do it. And then after the lectures, you can still do it on your own. So let's get the packet tracer up. And first I'll explain to you what exactly that we have here. Okay, so if you have downloaded Bob the Builder, you will get a file with three networks. So before I start, can I just know, anybody have any issues getting the file? Just show me a 6 if you already got the file. Everybody fine? Do you get the file? Someone say something so that I know I'm still alive. Am I still online? Okay, cool. Please don't leave me alone here, because I do not know whether I'm talking to myself or I'm talking to you. So here, a very simple network here. You have three LAN, LAN 1, LAN 2, and LAN 3. Bob, the builder, actually already built the network. Okay, so Bob is he's working for this company, and then build this network, all the hardware is done, but he need to assign IP address to all the PC here before he can complete the whole project. So there are two parts to his project. First one is he built the hardware, which is already done for you. The second part is he need to know what is the correct IP to put into this all PC so that everyone can get online. That's the most important thing, which is what we are going to help Bob to do it, because Bob didn't take data comm and he didn't know what is the right IP to put. So we'll start with the first LAN one here. Now when you open this file, you will notice that there are a separate windows, something like this here. So you'll see that you have this thing called a PT activity. So what do you have here is the instructions that you need to follow while you're helping Bob out today. Okay, now this one you will see at the bottom left corner on the PT activity, that is a completions. So that is the point. Okay, now by the end of this stream, if we manage to help Bob, then you'll get 16 out of 16 to show that Bob has done all his job, and yay, he can win the Employee of the Month award. And if by chance you set something wrong and you want to know what is wrong, you can also click on the check results to see what is currently wrong so you can go and fix it. Okay, so that is packet tracer activity. And in fact, you should know that in lab test one, you will get something very similar to this. This is not everything that you'll get in lab test one. This is part of it. But now this is a little bit of the flavor. If you want to know what is the flavor that you will have in lab one, something like this, but with a lot more complexity. Okay, now, getting back to this network here, you see the first instruction here is that you'll have to set IP address for all 5 PC. We'll start with the first PC here. Now, you see in the instructions, we know that we have to set the first address for PC1 and the second address for PC2. Now, first thing, I need you to change something here. Guys, on the place of PC2, this set first is supposed to be set second, okay? So PC1 will put first IP, PC2 will put second IP, but the instruction here is a bit wrong. You cannot change this on packet tracer, so just change it on the mine. You don't have to change it, like actually changing it. So later on when you are configuring this, make sure that you know PC2 is using the second IP. Okay, so hold a minute. Now, before we can configure the IP, we need to learn how to calculate for this IP address first. So I'll get back to this example here. Now let's say we start with LAN. What do you mean by 16 or 18? Okay, we start with the first LAN here, and we know that, let's say, now you should know that there are two ways this can happen. First is, you'll be given an IP address of a PC in LAN 1. If you get an IP address of a PC in a LAN, and if you know the subnet mask of that network, you can calculate the network address. Okay? Now, in some other cases, you will get the network address straight away. In that case, you do not have to calculate for the network address. Now, for your case, it is 18, correct? Because yours is running on Windows. If you're running on Windows, you'll get 18. Two extra marks for you. Okay, now, so let's say if we know PC1 is, okay, now this is just an example to teach you how to calculate. Okay, by right, we didn't know what is IP of PC1. So let's say PC1 IP is 192.168.1.1/24. So over here, we know that this network LAN 1, the subnet mask is /24. One of the PC inside is having 1.1. Now, with this information here, these two things, you can count the network address. So that is exactly what we want to do next. So what is the network address? Okay, now for you to count the network address, you have to take these two values, do the AND operations. But before that, you need to convert this into binary notations. So what we'll do here is, I will rewrite this one for you so that later on you can see this clearer. So I will write in this way. So 192.168.1.1/24. Now, convert 192 to binary. Again, I'll use my favorite calculator here, and let's see what do I get now. You have to be careful here. If you are using this one again, you have to make sure you are going from decimal to binary this time. So change this up on the top. And once it is ready, you can put in your decimal number 192. Convert, and then you will get the binary is 11000000. So I'll write this down here. 11000000. Let me move this away first. So that is the first octet. I get 192 convert to binary. So next one, I'll do this for 168. So I'll type 168 here, convert. Then I'll get 10101000. Okay, next. I want to convert 1. So actually 1 convert decimal to binary, it is still 1. So you have 1 here, but remember you have always need 8 bits in each order. So remember to pad it to 8 bits, add another 70 in front, and again the last one is 1. So 0000001. And that is the binary number that is converted from PC1 IP address. Okay, so this is the same IP in binary notation. Now, the next thing is you want to do an AND operation with the mask /24. So what does the /24 mean? Remember, 24 means I have 8, 24 bits of 1 in the network bits. So over here, to make this clearer, you should know that the first 8 bits here is, first 24 bits is for the network, and then the last 8 bits is for the host. And this will be the same for the network mask. Okay, so here 24 means I have 1111111 for the first octet, again another 81 in the second octet, and then another 81 in the third octet. Then for the last octet is all set to zero. Okay, so once you have this, the next thing you do is you do an AND operations with these two addresses. And if you're not familiar with AND, then to make this simple, if you have 2 1 and 1 with 1 and with 1, then you'll get a 1. Other than that, anything else, you'll get 0. Okay, so just remember it, this is a simple way. If you have 2 1, you'll get a 1. Other than that, it's all 0. So now we'll do this bit by bit, starting from the leftmost bit. So I'll zoom this into the 192 sections here. And then we have to start with the leftmost bit. So 1 and 1, you'll get a 1. 1 and 1, you get a 1. 0 and 1, you get a 0. 0 and 1, you get a 0. And doing the same, you'll get 0, 0, 0 here, because anything that ends with 0 is always 0. And you'll do the same for the second octet, which is 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0. Now, if you haven't noticed already, you might think, you might see that I'm actually just copying back the value, which is some, this is a trick here. So every time you do an AND operation with 1, if you see all 1s, you'll get back exactly the same value, okay? So, which means you don't have to do this bit by bit. Now, again, because at another 8-1, I will always get back the same value, so I will just rewrite the same value of the PC IP address here. And then we move on to the last octet. It's 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Now, this is the last bit here is 1, 0, so you get a 0. And that is your network address. So this thing that you have here is the network address in the binary notation. Okay? Yeah, cool. That is a very big step forward. But for clarity, most of the time you would like to convert this back to decimal. And if you want to convert this back, again, you'll be doing the same thing with your calculator here. But remember to swap from binary to decimal. And then you can just put in 1100000. Now you do a conversion, you'll get 192. You do the same here, you get 168, you get 1, you get 0. Now again, this is another thing that you might have noticed here. I'm actually rewriting back the same value, which is true. So like I say, what I said earlier, if you have all ones, you will always get back the same value. Okay, so your network address is given here. This is in decimal notation, which is 192.168.1.0. So that is the network address for LAN 1. That's how you get the network address. Okay. Now, if you are clear about this, the next thing you want to do is we want to also find out what is the broadcast address for LAN 1. And then from there, we will find out what is the usable IP address range. So, remembering this address here, we go on to the next example here to calculate what is the broadcast address, the first address, and the last address. So here, before this, we have 192.168.1.0. This is a net address. Now, I will still rewrite this address for you for clarity, but in fact, you don't have to do this again. So what we are interested to find is what is the net address for LAN 1? What is the broadcast address for LAN 1? And then we also want to find what is the first usable IP. And then we also want to find what is the last usable IP. So there are four things that we want to find out here. Okay? Now, for the network address, in fact, you already got this, so you can just write 192.168.1.0. Okay, now, here, this is the important part. Okay, for you to find a network address in general, the rule says that we will set all the host bit to zero. This is important, so I write this down. To find net address, you set all the host bits to 0. Now, to find the broadcast address, you set all the host bits to 1. So this is the two rules that you should always follow when you're calculating for the network addressing. So again, here, first, if you want to find the network address in the place where you find all the host bits, set all of them to 0. Now, the last address of the network, which is also the broadcast address, you go to the host bit, set all of the host bit to 1. Okay, this is the fundamental, this is the principle that will be followed in this example. So I will take this away, out of the way, and then we'll continue with our example here. Okay, now, which means that now we are trying to get the broadcast address. Let me hide my face for a while. I'm blocking the view. Okay, now, this one is done. We are looking at this one here. The last address. So you see, again, if you are not familiar yet, you can always see this is /24. So this first tree is the network. The last octet is the host, which means that the same thing here is this is the network bit. This is the host bit, which also means for all here is the same. Okay. Now, based on what I said earlier, because you have all ones, you always get back the same value. So in this case, I do not want to rewrite. I do not want to show you the calculations to save some time. But you should know that you always get back the same number in the network portions. Okay? Now, remember what does the rule say? For the broadcast address, set all the host bits to 1. So over here, it means that I need to set here 1111111. Now, just now, how do I get a 0 here? It's because I have 8 zeros. Okay, if I write this in binary notation, 8 zeros will translate to 0 in decimal. So, based on the rules, set all 8 bits of host bits to 1. If you translate this binary to decimal, you'll get 255. Which means that the broadcast address for LAN 1 is 192.168.1.255. Okay, now that means now we have already get the first address and the last address. And remember, first address is always the network address. Last address is always the broadcast address. First address cannot give to any host because that number will represent the entire network. Okay, that means Utah network will have 1 network address, your network 1 network address. Okay, maybe Apple have 1 network address, which is the first address that you count. That one cannot give to any host, okay? It has to be shared by everybody. Now, the broadcast address, which is the last address, like what we said earlier, is used when you want to send a message to everyone else in the network. Instead of sending one by one, you can just send to everyone else using one address. That's the broadcast address. In this case, it is 255. And again, this address you cannot give to any host. If you give to any host, then you cannot send to everyone else already. We want to reserve these two addresses for these two reasons. Okay? Now, then what is the address that I can assign to the host? That is we call the first usable IP until the last usable IP, which is what you see here on the screen. So over here, for me to find the first usable IP, it's very simple. I take the network address plus 1. That is the first IP I can use, so it will be 192.168.1.1. That is, okay, hold on. I have to refresh the screen for a while. So now, if you can see here, the first address is given by taking the network address plus 1, and then you will get 192.168.1.1. The last address is given by taking the broadcast address minus 1. So here, 255 minus 1, I will get 192.168.1.254. So this is how you get the range. And this thing here, we call them usable address range. Okay, so again, to recap, normally you will have to find these kind of addresses, the network address, which is all host bit 0, broadcast address, all host bit is 1, remember to convert back to decimal, and how do you know what address you can assign to the PC? You take the network address plus 1, that is the first address. The last one is you take the broadcast address minus 1, that is the last address. Okay, so if you are clear about how I get this address range, then we will go back to Bob network to help Bob to put in the IP address for the PC in that one. So we are back on the Bob network here, and if you follow the instruction again, you see that you want to assign the first IP address to Bob to PC1. So first IP in LAN 1. So what you do is go to PC1 and then go to the desktop tab, click on IP configurations, and you want to put in the first address 192.168.1.1. That's the first one you can use. Now, subnet mask is /24. Remember, machine only understand decimal notation. So we have to write 255.255.255, which in fact is automatically auto-completed. If you left click once, packet tracer will auto-complete this for you, so you don't have to type this. Then you have last one is the router. Default gateway is the router for LAN 1, the pink color network. So before you can fill this up, you have to think about this. In this network, who is the router? Router 0. So right now you will be seeing something like this. Okay, now you should see something like this, and you see right now this router 0 here is connecting to 3 networks. The pink color one, the yellow color one, and the blue color one. Now, each interface or each port on the router goes to a different network. We call this the interface on the router. So when you configure network, when you configure the router for the pink color network, you need to put in the IP address of the router in here. So I will see my, can you look at my mouse here? So my mouse is pointing here. So there are this line here, okay? So for this router, you will have 3 IP address because you connect 3 network. But you don't put the IP for other network here. You have to put the IP here. So how do I know that what number is this? What interface is this? Now on router, this is labeled by, we call this fast Ethernet or Ethernet, okay? So how do you see this? It's very simple. Go to preference on packet tracer, go to preference, and then you need to make sure that you turn these functions on. You check on always show port labels. So if you click on this one here and you go back to the network, again I show this to you, in the preference, click always show port labels, and then if you go back to the network here, you will see now all the numbers appear on the router. Okay, I need you to tell me whether you can see this number on your router before I go on to the next one. Okay, cool. Thanks for the feedback. That means I'm still alive. And now, you will notice that the number that you have is different from mine. Okay? So this is another important thing that you have to remember, because in the exam, everyone will get different number. Okay? Which means that when you want to set IP address on this router, you have to make sure what is the right number that you see. You cannot follow my one or follow your friends. Okay? Because every router is different. Now for your case, it will be different, so you have to check what is the interface that is connecting to the pink color network. For my case, it is FA00. You see, FA10 is used to go to yellow color. FA01 is go to blue color. FA00 go to pink color. That is the one that I want. So I will go into this router here. I click on this router and then I go under configurations, go to configs, and then on the left side is where you see all the interface. So as you can see, there are so many interface on the router. You have to pick the right one. So now I want to configure this for the pink color network, so I have to go to Fast Ethernet 00. FA is a short form for Fast Ethernet. Okay, now in over here, normally for router IP, we want to assign the last IP address or the first IP address for the router. So in this case, let's make this a standard for everyone. So to standardize, we will put the last IP address in LAN1 for router. So the last IP is what we have just got earlier, 192.168.1.lastusable.254. Okay, now you just left click on the subnet mask, you will get the 255.255.255, and then, okay, oh yeah, okay, now if your device is off, I will come back to this later. Now go back to your router here, because what I tell you is this packet tracer is very real. This game is so real that if you don't turn off the machine, you cannot use. And the reason it's off is because I turn it off. I want to save electricity. Now DNB is very expensive, you know. So for you to use, go to the physical tab. See this physical tab? This is the real router. Remember that I have shown you this one. Exactly the same that what you have seen, the real stuff. You have to find the power button here. So over here, you'll see a power button. You left click on the power button, and then it will turn on the router. If you see green color, means it is on. You see, this package really is so real. And then if you cannot see, if you still cannot see, you can always zoom in. Zoom in, and then you can find the power button here. Okay, if you click once, then it will boot up the router. Now this will take a few seconds, so we'll wait for your router to boot up first. While booting, I will show you how I configure the router. Okay, so if your router is already running, go back to the configuration tab and then choose the right interface. For my case is FA00. I use the last IP address here, 254. The mask automatically complete for you. And then you have to press the on button. This is very important. Most of the people, 50% of the people will forget this. So don't forget, press on the on button. That is how you turn on each interface on the router. So you need to turn on the whole router first, and then on each interface you have to turn on again. So that is two times you have to turn it on. And once you do that, it means you already set the router IP properly. So I will give you a few seconds here, since your router is still starting up. So once it is ready, make sure you put this in, and then you'll go back to PC1 to put this router IP into PC1. Okay, so for those who are done, get back to PC1 here, go to a configuration screen. In the place of default gateway, you put in your router IP, 192.168.1.254. That's it. So if you have done this, of course you'll be guessing, I should have done this correctly, right? Now, don't have to guess, because there is a way for you to find out whether you have done this correctly, and that is by checking on the score that you get. Okay, so right now, if you already know this is right, doesn't matter, just to show off, I will still show you the result. And if you go to the activity screen, go to the bottom left, you see that it's 4 out of 16. Yeah, now we already get 4 marks, we have a few more to go. And you can click on this check result. If you click on check result, yeah, if you get 4 is correct, you can actually see what is wrong and what is right. Okay? So, of course, right now you'll see a message like this, because this is how I encourage you, don't give up. You are still in the early stage of the game, okay? Still early game. And if you click on this assessment item here, you can actually see all the things that you do right or you do wrong. So, over here, you see that we have set PC1 properly. Yay, 3 points here. And then router. Router, you got 3 interface. We already set 1 correctly. Yay. So that's how I get 4 points. Okay, Now, based on the same thing, let's get back to packet tracer, and then now we want to go to PC2. So I go to PC2. Again, I change the instruction. PC2 will use the second IP. So same thing here, go to config, type in 192.168.1.2. You have to be very familiar in such a way that even without looking at the keyboard, you can type. So 1.2 is the second address, the mask, and the same router IP. So all the PC in the same network will have the same router IP, 1.254. If you have done so, close this, and let's check if we get some few more extra points here. So if I check the result here, yeah, right now we have done the right config for PC1, PC2, and we only have 3 more PC to go. Okay? Now for those who are thinking how to check, again, you have to find the windows for this packet tracer first. Now for those who are already in here, you can just close this window by click on X, then it will bring you back to the activity. But for those who want to know how to check, you need to see this screen first. Without this screen, you cannot check. If you don't see this, it is somewhere on the background, alternate tab to bring this up. And then you click on the check activity here, check results. And this will bring you to the screen where it will show you what is right and what is wrong. Okay, now we have only 3 minutes left. I will move on to LAN 2 so that you know, so that we can finish at least until up to LAN 2, which is what you need going to the next lab, because next week we have lab. Okay, so let's look at LAN 2. LAN 2 is having IP address 192.168.2.1. So PC3, one of the PC in LAN 2, is having 2.1 with the subnet mask /24. So using what we have learned earlier, you can easily calculate the range that you need. So I will, yeah guys, if you do not like what he's singing, I will just tell him, okay, give me a minute, let me tell him that he is a bit noisy. Okay. Welcome to the jungle. Now, going back to, I'll show you how I calculate for the next LAN 2 first. Told you this is the magic one. And when you're alone in Kampa for too long, you do not have anyone to talk to, you start to learn how to talk to a dog, a cow, a cat, a dog. So now I speak a lot of languages. Okay, now, coming back to the example here, we are in LAN 2, you have one IP address from LAN 2, 168.2.1/24. So again, you will need to calculate for network address, first usable address, last usable address, and the broadcast address. Oh, 230, never mind. I'll just finish this one very quick, and then the last PC5, I will show this to you when we continue on the next Tuesday. So I will show you very quick because I will show you a shortcut. Okay, now you see, this is /24. So last one here is for the host. First 3 is for the network. Now, in this case, it is, oh, the DOF is back again. Never mind. So remember, because the first 3 is 255.255.255, you will always get back the same value. So actually, this is a shortcut that you can learn. In fact, you do not have to calculate them manually. You can just rewrite here. Okay, hold on, let me color this back. So here you have 192.168.2. And then for the network address, this is another trick. Remember the first rule says that all the host bit set to 0, you will get the network address. So if I set all here to 0, 80 here, then I will try convert to decimal, I'll get 0. So actually, the network address is 192.168.2.0. Okay, now I will do the same for the broadcast address, 192.168.2. Now, the rule says that all the host bit set to 1. So 11111111. Press the calculator, translate this to decimal, you'll get 255. So actually, the last address here is 192.168.2.255. Now, first and last is very simple. First usable. When I say first and last, it's first usable and last usable. So take the network address plus 1, you'll get the first usable address, 192.168.2.1. To get the last usable address, take the broadcast address minus 1, so you get 254. And this will get you the range of all the addresses that you can use. Okay? Now, if you are clear about this, let's quickly go back to Bob, to help Bob. And you have to be a bit careful with the instructions here. So take a look here. For PC3, you want to set the second last usable. Okay, last second usable. Which means that if the last IP, the last usable is 254, the second last is 254 minus 1 is 253. Correct, right? So that means I go into PC3. Now I can do this very quick because you're already familiar. Don't worry. You'll make your phone proud. So 2.253, the last second usable. Okay? Now the default gateway is the last address of LAN 2. So you see, default gateway here, my one is FA01. Your one could be different. So please check properly what your interface is. I will go to FA01 in the router, and then I put in the last usable IP, 192.168.2.254. Remember to turn it on. That's it, done. So I can go back to PC3. I put in the router IP, 192.168.2.254. That's it. That's done for PC3. Now, going back to the instruction again, we have one more PC to go, PC4. We want to set the 10 usable. 10 usable means that starting from 1, you come until 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So the 10 usable IP is actually .10. Remember, like all programmers say, array start with 0. Now, in network also the same. 0 is for network address. So we start with 1, not 0. And the 10 usable IP is 192.168.2.10. Now, the router IP will be the same, 2.254. So if you have done so, it means that you have already finished all the things that you need to set for LAN 2. Just to be sure, you can do a quick check. And by now, you should get 12. Yeah, that's correct. So from the screen here, you see that, yeah, we are done for most of the thing. 1, 2, 3, 4 is done. So we only really have one more PC 5 to go. And I will continue this one on next stream. On Tuesday, 8 in the morning. Okay, so that's all for this stream, guys. Thank you for joining. If by the end of the class is a bit fast for you, that's fine. You can always replay the video and then just try to see what we have done. But anyway, LAN 1 and LAN 2 is the same, except that LAN 1 is .1, LAN 2 is .2. So I hope you have learned something new today. In this class, you have learned how to calculate the network address range. That's very important. So on the next stream, I will show you how you calculate the same thing for a CIDR, because that one is a bit different. And then, okay, yeah, I have one more thing to tell you. The one that you see right here for LAN 3 is /24 mask. There is something wrong. Change that to /25. Okay, now in this example, LAN 3 is using /25, but the display is a bit wrong. You cannot change this directly. Doesn't matter, just remember this in your mind that LAN 3 subnet mask is /25. So for those who can do this, you can try this out on your own. If you cannot, I will show you how to do this on the next stream. Okay, so until then, I'll see you again. And remember, you will have your lab coming back next week as well. So thank you for joining. Happy weekend, DJF. Peace out.
She's sweet but a psycho, a little bit psycho. At night she's screaming, I'm on my mind. Oh, she's hot but